Loving it. So I'm delighted to share with you this morning. It's been a while, and I'm here every Sunday, but usually I'm sitting at the computer behind the camera. So today it's a treat to share with you. And so the title of my talk today is Finding Gifts in Challenging Times. And, you know, considering we're in sort of a collective challenging time, I thought it would be a really good opportunity for us to have a bit of a conversation around the time we're in and the gifts that can be found in it. So if you're like me, you can look back in your life and see the gifts from challenges. Do you have that experience? You know, maybe it was a really challenging relationship and you discovered something about yourself, or maybe, a health issue sort of gave you the gift of really being kinder with your body, with yourself, or maybe a career challenge taught you something, maybe set you on a new path. So I find that, you know, if I look back in my life and I've had some significant challenges, and if I look back on those, there's always been a gift in them for me. I had a challenging marriage that ended in divorce in my mid-20s, and the gift from that was my son. And my son has grown into this amazing young man and is truly one of my favorite people on the planet. Mm-hmm. So there's that gift that we find in the challenges. But now that we're in a time of challenges, I think that it helps us to be able to see the gift in the moment, because often I haven't been able to see it until much later. So speaking of challenges, I am in ministerial training right now. So I'm training to be a minister within our movement, and I am not even going to get started on the challenges and the gifts of that experience. One of my classmates, Jamie is on here, so I know she knows what I'm talking about. But anyway, as part of our studies, we take two levels of a course called Minister as Speaker. And we had the good fortune of being taught by Dr. Deb and Dr. Ken. We couldn't have been more fortunate. They are two of the most engaging and profound speakers in this movement. So we were very, very fortunate. And one of the things they taught us in the course was that if you're going through a personal challenge as a minister, that it's really good to kind of go all the way through it, get to the other end, make sure you've got the healing from it before you share that experience on a Sunday morning, because it can be a profound experience to share and people can engage with it, but you really want to get to the point where you have your own healing in that. And that's really good advice. And right after this talk today, I'm going to take that advice. So today, I'm a little nervous about sharing, my feeling that it was important to share outweighed my concern that maybe I shouldn't be sharing about a challenge that I am currently knee deep in. Mm-hmm. So in January of this year, I was diagnosed with clinical burnout. And I am still in this journey, and it is a current challenge for me. But the reason I wanted to talk about it today is because I'm seeing in the media burnout is reaching epidemic proportions. So I think it is so important that we talk about what's real, we talk about what's relevant for people right now. So burnout, I'd heard the term used to refer to people who were stressed out and fatigued and exhausted, and I didn't actually know that it is a clinical condition that's been researched for 40 years. So basically, to sum it all up, it is extreme exhaustion. It has often things like compassion fatigue, cynicism is a really big part of it, and what happens is people lose their ability to function, and it's a significant challenge. So at this point, there are articles about frontline workers, helping professionals, and even caregivers, parents and caregivers who have had to step up, who aren't getting necessarily the same social connection, who have had the stress and pressure of the pandemic, which has increased the demands on them and perhaps decreased the social supports. So our culture actually glorifies burnout. There's a lot that's been written on this. So Christina Maslach is one of the people that has researched burnout, and she's actually created a burnout inventory that can to diagnose it. Michael Leiter is also a researcher and has also done work on burnout, and actually he is the one who, I heard him recently on a podcast, and he was talking about just the enormous number of frontline workers, nurses, who are experiencing burnout right now. Greg McEwen is somebody who's written a book called Effortless. And what he says our culture glorifies burnout as a measure of success and self-worth. Ooh. Yowza. Claudia Hammond has just written a book called The Art of Rest, and she said the same thing. And you know what she said is if we look back in history and we looked at signs of success in people, it was actually the opposite. We looked at people who had leisure time as being successful. Often, you know, women were seen as if they had more weight, were carrying more weight, that they were more successful. And nowadays, if you think of how that's changed, the people in our lives who are busy, who are on the go, who've got a meeting, and those are the people that we tend to think, oh boy, they must be important. They must be very successful. So culturally, we've had a shift that I think is not serving us well. So if we go beyond, there are those of us who are experiencing clinical burnout. There is another concept called languishing. And Adam Grant is an organizational psychologist who I follow. And he's actually just wrote an article in the New York Times. And the article was called, That Blah You're Feeling is Called Languishing. So he talked about during this time where we're at home a lot more, we don't have the same social connections, there's more stress going on, our lives have been sort of up, there's been some upheaval in some capacity. And he talked about that, this is actually a sociological term, languishing. And basically there's, you know, depression. And then there's thriving. You know, depression is that place of sort of despondence. Thriving is that place where we're motivated and we're excited. And he said, you know, in the middle is this place called languishing. And languishing is basically a sense of stagnation, a bit of an emptiness, and that it is basically an absence of well-being. And what it does is it dulls our motivation and it really sort of disrupts our focus. So I think if we broaden sort of the definition, we look at the people who are experiencing clinical burnout and we go all the way to the people who perhaps are languishing right now, I think there are probably a large number of people who fall into that or at some time over the last year and a half have had that experience. Mm-hmm. And now, you may be saying, I showed up for a Science of Mind talk. Why are we talking about things that are really a downer, literally and figuratively? And, you know, Adam Grant actually talks about toxic positivity and just the importance of us recognizing that we have negative emotions, that it is okay. And, you know, I think we have a little bit of that sometimes in our movement where we have that, well, we turn away from conditions, we treat for what we want to see, and we live in that place of possibility. And all of those are great, but just to clarify, Ernest Holmes did not ever say that we deny the reality of suffering in our current experience. What he taught is that we recognize that suffering in itself has no power. And so that's why I really wanted to sort of bring the topic forward today and to talk a little bit about it, that I think it is an experience, and certainly I'm not putting it on to you if this is not anything you've experienced, but maybe there are people in your life who have. And I just hope that this brings a little bit of understanding. And I know through my own journey, if nothing else, this has made me incredibly understanding. You know, if somebody doesn't reply to me, replies with negativity or frustration, you know, I've got a little bit more understanding of, you know, they may be going through something right now. So, as I mentioned, in every challenging situation, there are gifts. And I think there are metaphysical gifts, and there certainly have been for me. And so that's what, you know, when I got into this place, and honestly, it's probably one of the most challenging experiences I've had in my life. And when I got there and I essentially hit the wall, I realized, I decided that I am going to commit to getting every lesson, every gift that I can. I will take everything I can from this experience, every gift, and carry those forward in my life. So the first gift I discovered is that I discovered that we live in a benevolent universe. When I got to a point that I could not function any longer, I had to stop. I had to let go of everything. And it was a beautiful experience looking back, because you know what happened? I was supported by the universe and I was held in that space when I let go. You know, I've always had people tell me that I am resilient, and I've been called driven and ambitious. And, you know, absolutely, I'm grateful for those aspects of me and they have brought me to where I am today. But, you know, there is another side to that. In that resilience, I just have an energy and a belief that I have to do it all. And so it's interesting that I found this teaching and it resonated with me, because one of the things we teach is personal responsibility. And you know, for somebody like me who felt like I have to do it all, I was like, great, personal responsibility. I've fought for everything in my life. That works for me. But obviously, I was missing another piece of that. Personal responsibility is not just me in my limited perspective pushing through life to gain everything I want and fix everything I want. It is allowing spirit within me. It is communing with spirit within me. I love Dr. Deb's meditation this morning, just getting that experience of spirit within. And so in the summertime, we live, live in a place called Lake Country, and we're surrounded by lakes. And one of the things I love to do in the summertime, especially in the evening after a really long, hot day, I love to go in the lake and just lie back. Have you ever done that? And you just lie on your back and just stare up at the beautiful blue sky, and you know, your ears get covered so it sort of muffles the sound. And I love that moment because it's that moment of just being fully supported by the cool water, and you've got the fresh air, and there's usually birds above. And that to me is sort of this experience that I've had, is I had to lay back. I had no other option. And what happened was I was supported by this beautiful, cool water. And that showed up in the form of an amazing healthcare team that have supported me. Like, I didn't even know why people went to the doctor before this. But you know what? I showed up and I asked for help. And that help, I can't even describe to you the help that has shown up. This beautiful Sunday Six have been such a source of support for me through this time. And the community, there are lots of people in this community. I've had to step back from a lot of my volunteer work and some of my studies, and I've had to take time off work. And it's amazing how many people have just reached out to me, shared their love with me, offered to support me and help me. And that has been a beautiful experience. So I'm going to get Derek to show a slide in a second. And My son sent this to me a couple of weeks ago. He said, oh, his girlfriend and him saw this on the internet and thought of me. So let's take a look at it. So that really is a sign when your son sees this message and thinks of you. And it's true. So you can go back to Derek. Thanks. So it is true. I have had a tendency to overcommit, to take on probably more than is reasonable. And I'm recognizing now that comes from a lack of faith. That comes from a lack of allowing, of lying back and allowing the universe to support me. So that gift I've taken from this, I am committed to carrying with me through my life, that I will now allow. I will allow the support. I will allow the support of the people around me. I will allow spirit within me to lift me up and so that I can rest in that place of support. And that brings me to the second gift that I've had from this experience. The second gift I discovered in this is that one of the most powerful actions I can take is to rest. Just rest. Now, I got to a point where I didn't have another option. Rest was all I could do. I was no longer able to function. And for a long time, actually, for a couple of months probably, I really couldn't do much at all. It really involved just resting, listening to audiobooks, you know, those types of things. But what I discovered in that is that that is a powerful, not just restorative action, but it actually is that piece of allowing. It's the piece where we are receiving inspiration before we send it out into the universe. So one of the things that I'll do a little exercise with you. So it's a little breathing exercise. So just take a little inhale. And now inhale again. And now inhale again. And just one more time inhale. So obviously, we can't do that. So if we recognize that there is a flow to our lives, that the quote I used was from one of our beautiful teachers in this program, Dr. Tom Sanner. And he said, to live a life of happiness, we realize that the universe is one of harmonious flow. Because we have the power of choice, we can choose to align ourselves with the flow or resist it. And for me, that rest was aligning with the flow. Again, if we think about water, you know, I've spent so much of my life in a rushing river trying to push that river, never really laying back and allowing the flow to carry me. And so in the second, a friend of mine who's going through a similar experience, and she's been a great support for me, sent me this meme. So this is the second slide. And this was her saying, here's a reminder if you need it. And so I appreciate that, you know, and what I found at the beginning, after a couple of months, I started to get a little bit of energy back. And I would write a list of things I wanted to get done in a day. And I mean, we're not talking earth shattering. We're talking, you know, make dinner, grocery shop, you know, just those basic things. And what I discovered was I would have to take all the list of things I wanted to do in a day and stretch it out for the week. This has been a really challenging lesson for me because it's so deeply ingrained to go, 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 produce, produce, produce. So I have been having to tell myself that one of the most powerful actions I can take is to rest. So, and in that rest, I've discovered the third gift has been my mantra through all of this. And I am so grateful to my partner, Derek, because he reminds me of this daily. And as I start to feel a little bit better, I can forget and he reminds me. And this is my mantra. I am my top priority. And in that, that's been so powerful for me. I am my top priority. And so if that is just simply laying back, if that means that I did a thing yesterday, so that's enough things, that's where I am today. So, and in all this process, I've had to learn to actually get still, to be able to check in with myself and to recognize what's needed from me right now. I'm my top priority. And that may be sometimes I will plan dinner in the morning and then I get halfway through the afternoon and I say, all bets are off. It's not going to happen today. And I so appreciate that I just had this space for that to happen. So, as I mentioned, Dr. Tom Sanner, he is a scholar on Ernest Holmes within our movement, and he's a brilliant teacher. And I love the way he describes the reciprocity of spirit in our lives. And what he said is that in our movement, we often have a tendency to lean too far into the metaphysical and perhaps lose some of that mystical. And he talks about that. In that, we can think of it sort of as, you know, that infinity symbol, is that we commune with spirit, we rest in that, and then we manifest from that place. So there, we need, as we know, like there are the two aspects, there's the love and the law. And I know absolutely for myself, I've been definitely just inhaling on the metaphysical side. And I've been creating from my limited perspective. And I'd really lost touch with that communing with the spirit within, waiting for the inspiration of the spirit within me. So Ernest Holmes said, our body is the servant of our mind, and our mind is the offspring of pure spirit. The three are really one and should work in unison with each other. This can be done only when the mind becomes aware of the spirit, permitting its flow of harmony, unity, and perfection, a clear passageway. Our body will always reflect this inner state of mental poise. Isn't that beautiful? And for me, it's such a great reminder. There's no pushing. There's no forcing. There's no figuring it out. There is just aligning with the harmony of spirit, creating from the place of that divine inspiration. And so this may all sound kind of selfish, and honestly, I have judged myself as being kind of selfish in these past few months. And you know, I loved this quote, and our beautiful Annie Zed creates some memes for us from quotes. And so this is the third slide, and this is a quote from David Hawkins. In this interconnected universe, every improvement we make in our private world improves the world at large for everyone. So isn't that great? It's just that reminder. And now we can just look at this in the external world. You know, because I did not rest, a lot suffered. You know, my own health suffered, but my relationship, I just was too exhausted to be fully present in my relationships. As a parent, at work, I was no longer able to support the students and serve them in the way that I really wanted to do. So it's not a selfish act. This aligning not only serves us, but on that bigger level, it serves spirit, it serves humanity, and it is in service to the highest good. So thank you for letting me share my story with you today. I want you to know that if you are going through a hard time, it will be okay. That I encourage you, if you're in that place where you're ready, to just lay back. And I trust that you will be supported by spirit. If you want a tangible vehicle for that support right now, reach out to the practitioner of the week. Reach out to any one of us and we will support you. I have been blessed in this community. And so if you are just going through that languishing, or you have gone through it, or you know somebody who has, I just encourage you to be gentle with yourself. to find the gifts, and maybe those gifts are the same as my gifts. Recognizing, communing with that feeling of spirit within you, recognizing that we live in a benevolent universe, knowing that one of the most powerful acts you could do is to rest, and knowing that as you do and you make yourself your own priority, you are in service to the world. So thank you for being here. Thank you for being on my journey. I love you. I bless you. Thanks.